Was there a point where you kind of felt like, you know what, I am good enough to actually do this? A drawing you did, or a year in college where you realized, I think I can actually do this, or it became real?
I'm lucky if I look back, 3 years and I'm happy with what I've done.
Welcome back to Making Imagination, the podcast that looks at animated filmmaking one craft at a time. I'm Wes, your host. On today's episode, we're going to talk about one of the crafts that is dearest to my heart, character design. And my guest today has worked with studios and clients like Disney, DreamWorks, Sci-Fi, Netflix, Mattel, and others, Randy Bishop. Randy's a character designer whose work caught my eye for his aesthetic and for the energy he infuses into his work. What's really interesting about him is, despite his incredible talent, he doesn't live in LA. But we'll get into that. If you're into character design, I hope you'll take inspiration and insight from this conversation. Here's my conversation with Randy Bishop. So speaking specifically of Netflix, getting some of your work for them, you worked on a short film they did called Canvas. Can you just talk through a little bit of some of that development process, kind of finding the designs and the characters and
what you so might Canvas try? Is actually Frank Abney. It was a personal project of his that he wrote and directed, and he funded himself.
Oh, wow.
Which, I mean, he did it. I'm actually really impressed that he actually got it done, because he was, like I said, he was just 100%. It was his project. He was funding it, right? He recruited the artist. He did, he directed it. He did a lot of the animating and stuff. He was at the time an animator at Pixar, and now, I mean, currently he's working as on a directing a feature at Netflix now. But at the time, it was just him and whoever he managed to recruit to jump on. That one was actually. He was a lot of fun to work with. He's a great guy. And he, for that one, the design, I designed the main character, the old guy in the wheelchair. And he had, and this happens quite a bit with clients. They'll have like a group of actors that they want to sort of, they want to have like a similar sort of feel to these actors in terms of personality or in terms of their look or attitude or whatever. So he gave me a few actors to look at. And from there, it was just kind of together, we worked through a few different iterations, but we landed on one that we both really liked. Anyway, Frank was awesome. He was really good to work with. I think part of it was that he's an artist himself, right? Who was working at a studio, so he knows exactly what it's like to work for somebody, right? To have an art director, to have somebody who knows what they want. So he was super easygoing, super easy to work with, super good to bounce ideas off of, and a really good communicator, everything like that. So I'm glad that he's at where he's at now. Because he did this short film wanting, like, he wanted to do his own stuff, right? Wanted to be a director, funded his own short film, then Netflix bought it, and then they hired him to do a feature. So,
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. That's cool. Cool. So then recently with Netflix, there was a new version of A Christmas Carol, Scrooge.
I have arranged for three visitors to call on you before morning.
Oh, hello. You can't change the past, but you can learn from it.
Are you ready to live your life now in the present?
Yeah, so you're working with a team to reimagine existing and beloved characters. So what were some of the challenges of working on that project specifically, and what are some of the high points?
That's probably been my favorite production to work on. Mostly because I was a big part of it for a long time. But the challenge with anything like that that's period specific, right, is there's a lot of research. So researching things like buttons and the way that trousers are cut and made and the way they fit and all this kind of stuff. There's a lot of research involved in character design in general. But when it's that specific, it gets a little bit more challenging because sometimes it can be hard to find the right reference, or you can feel limited, a little too limited sometimes. Like an artist will just take something straight, like an outfit straight off of Pinterest or straight out of, you know, an old newspaper or something, because they feel so restricted by the period. Like it limits the way that they can think outside of, you know, outside of the box or whatever. So I think those are challenges that are inherent in just about any project, but especially with period specific and accurate. Yeah, it was a really fun job. Lots of great artists. It was really fun to be part of it. Part of what I loved about that was I kind of became the style guy, I guess, for lack of a better word. So lots of concepts, right? Lots of different people doing different concepts. And then from there, I would get the rough concept or something close to a final concept, and then redesign it or repaint it to be in style of the show for the modelers, you know. It was a lot of fun because I got to touch just about almost every character in the show. I had my hands on at some point, which was really cool.
Looking at specifically Ebenezer Scrooge, I think at first glance, looking at the poster, he's a little bit more youthful than I would have expected to find Ebenezer Scrooge. He's a little bit more stylized. But then when I watch the film and I see what you guys were trying to do with him as a character, and also when I heard the voice actor, it all worked really well. I actually really enjoyed that character. And while you're designing, you know, lead characters for a project like that, are you aware of the voice actor when you're going into it, or are you just blank slate? You're doing you.
They were doing casting while we were designing characters, right? So Scrooge's design was the first thing. So Nicholas Cole did the original concepts for Scrooge and for the main three ghosts. And they changed and evolved a little bit from there. Scrooge probably the most, but he pretty much had those done before anything else was done. So Stephen Donnelly, the director, put a pitch together, right? For this new take on A Christmas Carol, and had Nicholas do the original designs. I did a expression sheet for it, and that was, I don't even know when. It was a long time ago. And then he came back to me later, a couple years later. He's like, hey, Scrooge got picked up by Netflix. We're going to do it. And at that point, Scrooge's design was pretty much done before it ever even got picked up. Occasionally you'll have a director or a writer will have a certain actor in mind. Hey, I imagine, you know, Jack Black as Poe for Kung Fu Panda, right? And that's what happens. But I think most of the time you start with a story, start with designs, and then from there you cast someone to hopefully fit the design, or, you know, after you cast, maybe you tweak the design a little bit.
Yeah. It felt like I could see that there was effort to both redesign and reimagine, to have a new take on the story, but also to remain faithful enough to the story that it wouldn't be unrecognizable. Which I think is probably challenging in and of itself. When it comes to character design, designing a character, what do you try to capture or convey through that character or that design?
Well, I think the most important part of character design is the story. Character design is just, I think, another avenue to explore in storytelling. So every character has a story, right? As a character designer, you have direct impact on how people experience the story, right? Because people experience the story through the characters. And so you're able to incorporate that into the design. So I'm always thinking about, okay, what's this character story? What's the role they play? How will they interact with other characters? If there's a script, that's important. I think just in general, always thinking about the story and how to take that story and put it into the character's design is like the number one thing.
It makes me think too, even just looking at your website, even the illustrations and the drawings that you design in the single frame themselves almost tell a story, which is interesting. I was just looking at an image you did of a lineup of people. I think it was people in a waiting room, and you can just look at this image and kind of figure out kind of what everyone's thinking and everyone's doing and almost the story of the waiting room, which that was cool. So kind of one of the, I think everyone kind of has a different pathway into however they get to, wherever they get to. I'm kind of curious as to yours, like what's your story as a character designer? What was your pathway into the craft and into getting work in the industry?
I didn't know about character design or what it was or anything as a kid, right? I just knew I wanted to make cartoons. When I went to college, I actually wasn't going to be an art major because I'd been convinced by different people that, you know, you can't make a living as an artist, right? You can't support a family. But I got to college and then I wanted to take art classes, right? I was going to be like an architecture or engineer major. I hadn't quite decided yet. But I also wanted to take art classes, but there was only one art class available. It was really dumb. It was like, this is a pencil, or this is paper. You know, it was, they didn't actually teach anything. And so I switched my major to art because I wanted to take the art classes. It was great. And then I had a professor who, she asked me one day, she's like, what's your plan? I was like, I don't know. I really don't know. I want to do art. She's like, have you thought about character design? It's like, I don't know what that is, but it sounds cool. Started learning about it and getting into it and decided that's what I really wanted to do. I got married during college, had the, you know, bills and all this kind of stuff. And I worked a bunch of different jobs, right? I did retail. I drove an ice cream truck. You know, I did all kinds of different things while also trying to, you know, build a portfolio and look for jobs. They were really hard to come by for a while. It was hard to get anybody to pay me to do anything. I got an email one day from Ben Acker and Ben Blacker, who are like these comic book writers. And I had been, there used to be this website called Project Rooftop. Hmm. So it was like this weekly challenge to redesign superhero, which was really fun.
Yeah, it sounds fun.
And they were like, oh, we saw your stuff on Project Rooftop. Do you want to work on this graphic novel? It's like, sure. And that was like my first like legitimate job. From there, it was just a series of happy coincidences and getting lucky. Right? I think people always ask, you know, how do you break into the industry? How do you get a job? I'm like, I really don't know. Honestly, it's hard. I mean, you can apply, you know, to studio. But if you're like me and you like living in Idaho and you don't want to move to California, that can be a problem, right? But anyway, lots of happy accidents, the right people meeting the right people, or the right people knowing about things that I've done, or, you know, being familiar with my work or whatever, just kind of built a client base and it keeps growing and things are good. You know, like all my, I did put a lot of effort into looking for work, but none of that worked. It just came down to the right people noticing.
Yeah, I've contemplated that kind of a thing, that kind of an answer, because other people within the industry in Hollywood have said kind of the same thing, like a little bit of luck and a little bit of, you know. I wonder though, because you did put a lot of work into even trying to get a job in the industry, even though it didn't pan out, like, is there something to be said for being prepared for when those kind of lucky breaks come? Because, you know, even just having the portfolio is more than just luck, you know. But I suppose the right people seeing it at the right time is certainly a happy coincidence, happy happenings.
Nothing happens completely by accident, right? You have to, like, if I hadn't put in a bunch of work to trying to build a portfolio, trying to build an online presence, and, you know, right, like nowadays, like, you have to have a social media presence as an artist, right, in order to get work, unless you're some sort of established guy that everybody knows and everybody loves, right? So that requires effort, right? And putting in the effort to build a portfolio, to do the kind of work that you want to be hired for, is totally necessary, right? I mean, I get a lot of jobs for model sheets. Like, there's this one studio, they'll just come to me consistently for model sheets. Like, hey, our people don't want to do this. Can you do model sheets? Like, sure, right? But that's only because I used to hate doing model sheets, right? I think they're tedious, or thought they were tedious and boring. But now I really like them, because I knew, right, this is something that has to be done. Right? I need to get good at it so that I can get that kind of work. And so... having the stuff that you want to work at, right? Whether that's doing model sheets or just straight up character design or illustration, whatever, you have to do it and show that you can do it well for people to, I mean, people can't notice if you don't do it, right? So there's a lot of work up front to get to the point where you're actually hireable.
Looking at your style and the work that you do, it is kind of a distinctive style, which can be challenging in a sea of artists. but the stuff that you do, I mean, has a lot of energy in the way that you draw, in the storytelling that you do, in the pictures that you draw. So I was kind of curious, like, who are some of the artists that have inspired you, or the characters that you've just thought, like, that's a great design, that have kind of funneled into your style?
That's a good question. There are a lot. I think the stuff that I liked to do, I was like the only kid in school who did it, right? I was like the kid in class who draws. That was like my thing growing up. And then so I went to college, used to being sort of a big fish in a little pond, and then suddenly it was like, you have no idea what you're doing, right? All these professors are like, you know what, this is cool, but it's not what you should be doing, or this is not right. You need to try, you know, work on this. You need to do this better. And one of the things that I really struggled with was drawing women. Growing up, I read a lot of comics, and that's kind of where I based my knowledge of anatomy, was in this world of comics. That's where I drew a lot of, basically, I mean, you look at comic books, nobody really wears clothes, right? It's like everybody's got these spandex jumpsuits, which is great if you're, you know, learning anatomy, right? So I got used to drawing like really ripped naked dudes, basically. But I had this thing, it made me really uncomfortable to try to draw the women, because I'm like, I don't know if I should even be looking at this, let alone, you know. Anyway, so I got used to, I got really good at drawing guys. There are lots of things like that. Like, I had a hard time drawing women. I had a hard time drawing clothing, because, like I said, I drew a lot of superheroes, right? Which are, they don't wear clothes. And so whenever I came up against something that I had a hard time with, I would find artists that I really liked who were really good at that and try to learn from them. So, for example, I love the way J.C. Leyendecker paints clothing and fabric. And so he's an artist that has been very influential in terms of how I draw clothes, how I paint clothes. Also Claire Hummel, she's like the queen of costuming. She knows exactly how clothes are constructed, right? She knows how they're supposed to fit. She knows all the layers, all the she's really good at clothing. Corey Loftus is just, he's a bigwig at Disney, and he's awesome. He can draw or paint anything. Love his stuff. There's the list is huge. I'll see something that I like, and I'll try to take that and incorporate it into my work somehow. Style is just kind of something that is your response to what you see, right? Or like your love letter to the art that you love, right? Mm-hmm. Like, oh, I love this guy. I love this person. I love this artist. I love her stuff. And you just kind of take all those things that you love and try to put it into something that is yours, right? And it just kind of, for me at least, it just kind of is something that happens as you try to take all those things that you love and bring them into your own work.
Yeah. That's an interesting answer. As you say that, it resonates with me. I think, you know, just in terms of like finding my own styles, in some ways feels like something of the process you just described, talking about, you know, the finding those artists that you really love and trying to incorporate some of that through the lens of you as an artist. That's really interesting. Yeah, I think that resonates. And the artists you just named are all incredible, which is a great place to start. So maybe you sort of got alluded to some of this in your, some of that answer, but how do you tend to approach designing a character? I mean, you've talked a little bit about story, and now you've talked some of, you know, some of those influences. Is there anything else you would add to when you sit down, I'm going to design this character? Kind of what is your approach?
Yeah. So as far as the process goes, I think it kind of varies. It's like the same process with just about any art form. You start really basic, right? And you go from general to detailed, right? You start with the most basic, most general, large shapes, biggest ideas, and kind of narrow your way in from there. And then once you land on a design that you like, something that I like to do is before doing model sheets, so like turnarounds, expression sheets, that sort of stuff, I like to explore different poses with the character because I found with a lot of designs, they could look really good in like a sort of static pose or sort of a generic pose. But once you start moving them around, sometimes things don't work as well, right? Maybe their costume obscures things in a weird way, or their arms, like I have this character who his arms were just too big, right? And like he couldn't actually move with them in the ways that he needed to move. So we had to adjust the design, you know, once we got to that point. So I think that's the way I like to do it. Start with really basic rough designs, work from there. Once I usually don't spend a ton of time on body types and stuff, just because I'll do like some rough body type sketches, right? And then I'll jump into faces and do a ton of iterations of different faces and everything, because the face, like if you've got like a long sort of thin face, you can't put that on certain body types, right? And the face is where clients usually fall in love with the design, is in the face. And so if you've got you do a bunch of faces, it's quicker and it's a lot easier for them to dial on what they want, and then from there you can kind of explore things a little bit more. But anyway, then after that stuff's all done, jump into model sheets, turnarounds, expression sheets, that sort of stuff. And then a lot of times too, I'll do paintings, like render out the characters the way that they would look in 3D, which is fun.
Yeah. Interesting. That kind of sends me all kinds of different directions. So you talked about going to college and kind of finding your path. Was there a point, I feel like in kind of every other story, depending on where you grew up, you know, maybe you're kind of better than your peers around you. And then you kind of go and get closer to the industry and discover that there's a whole lot of talent out there. And I think a lot of us, when we're very young, have a lot of confidence in the work that we're doing. But then as you get older and kind of look back, you think, oh gosh, you know, I had so much to learn, so much to grow. I'm curious, like, was there a point for you in your, just as you were honing the craft, was there a point where you kind of felt like, you know what, I am good enough to actually do this? A drawing you did or a year in college where you realized, I think I can actually do this, where it became real?
I don't know, because I'll look back at stuff. I'm lucky if I look back, you know, 3 years and I'm happy with what I've done. Like, I feel like I still am kind of, like, I feel comfortable with what I do, right? And I feel confident in my ability to provide clients with what they want. But there's always this sort of nagging voice inside my head that says you can do better, right? You can push more, you can grow more, right? And so I think I still don't feel like I've, you know, arrived, if that makes sense. Like, sure. I feel like as an artist, you should be always trying to improve and trying to learn, and you have to adapt to different, like, new circumstances, new technologies, new ways of working and that sort of thing. And so it did take me a while to get to where I am now, where I'm comfortable, feel confident in what I do. I think that didn't happen until, I mean, like, it's only been like 2 or 3 years probably since I felt like I belong here, you know?
Wow, yeah.
Just because I think part of that too is that I am separated from the industry, right? I don't have any coworkers. It's just me by myself here in Idaho, right? And so before COVID, every year I would go to I'd go to CTN every year, which was like my favorite thing, right? It's like, actually, like, every time I go, I'm like, okay, maybe I do belong here, right? Maybe I do kind of fit in with these awesome artists and stuff. But then I'd come home and be all isolated again and start doubting things and be like, you know what? I don't feel like I'm really part of things, right? Because, so it wasn't until, I don't know, it's been, you know, 2 or 3 years ago probably, that I finally was like, okay, I feel good. I feel like I'm part of things and like I can do this and I'm, you know, confident in the way that I do it type deal.
Yeah, that makes sense. Now, looking on your website, you have more than just artwork. You also have a blog that you'd written a few posts for, which, just in looking at your blog, it reveals that you're really thoughtful and that you have read probably more than some of us. I was impressed with how many sort of external sources you link to in writing, particularly on the power of story. That was one where you had a lot of sources cited within your work, rather than it just being an opinion piece. Here's what I think, and then, you know, publish. That said, are there books or articles or ideas on the craft of story or on craft of character design or story that have affected your approach to drawing? Was there any of those kind of something you read that kind of became part of how you approach things?
I think really anything that is written by Brian McDonald, he's really good. He's a screenwriter and he writes some really brilliant things on storytelling that I think correlate directly into working as a character designer. I mean, there are lots of, I haven't read a ton of books on, like, specifically on story and character design and stuff, but I do read a lot. But it's usually, I like to read fiction, right? I just like to read good stories. And I think that is part of, I think, being engaged in someone else's creativity, right? Whether that's through a book or a film or a play or music or whatever, you're able to, like, every artist has some story to tell, right? Every writer, every songwriter, every dancer, right? Everybody has this art, they're using this art form to communicate, right? To tell a story. And there are, I can't tell you how many times I've been reading and I'll get an idea for something that inspires a project that I'm working on currently. I'm like, oh, you know what? This character in this book has this issue or whatever, and they describe it in this way. I could use that to, you know, help push this character I'm working on in this, in a similar way or whatever. I think there's something really powerful about experiencing in like sort of submerging yourself in someone else's story, right? And experiencing the way that they create inspires and can't help but affect the way that you create, right? The way that you do things and the way that you think and the way you work.
Interesting. It's really cool to hear. Yeah, hear you just talking about reading and story. And because I do think that art becomes richer when you incorporate other disciplines into it. So for instance, reading and reading storytelling to affect the way that you design characters. You know, reminds me of, I'm a big fan of the film director, Christopher Nolan. And there was a movie, Dunkirk, when he did Dunkirk, he, I think, looked at like music theory, and that's just a fascinating to structure his story. And I think it's fascinating when you cross disciplines. I think you get a more interesting result in your own craft, as an aside. So my next question has to do with kind of rules. I think when it comes to, and principles, I want to say just rules, rules and principles. So for instance, Disney's Nine Old Men, when they would animate, they would famously say things like, animate what the character is thinking, not what he's doing. And came up with the 12 principles of animation. And from there, I think people, animators have kind of come up with, you know, methods for, animating that are helpful based on those 12. And I think there's something similar when it comes to character design. There are, at least I've come across what seem to be kind of principles or rules for designing characters to make sure that, you know, that the silhouette reads, for instance, or if you have, you know, an ensemble cast, you know, make sure that you can tell them each, you know, their attitudes or whatever from a single image of all of them, that kind of a thing. Would you add any rules or principles or observations that you've discovered or noticed or things that you think about? And are there any that you would consider like breaking if someone were getting too caught up, for instance, in some of those principles?
Yes. I think with any art form, I feel like you have the basic principles and elements of design, right? You have, you know, shape and color and texture and line and, you know, repetition with variation and all these other things that you learn about that are, those hold true, I feel like, no matter what discipline you're working on, no matter what it is that you're doing, regardless of the art form, I think those principles hold true almost all of the time, right? As far as specific rules or principles with character design, I think there's something that I read, Brian McDonald, his book, The Golden Theme. Mm-hmm. He's talking about writing, right? He's talking about storytelling, and about how basically like the mythology of your story need to be clear about the rules of your story from the beginning, right? If you have a world that's magical, right? And there are rules to this magic, whatever, you need to establish that early on in the story. So if you get like halfway through the story and then suddenly you introduce magic and you had no idea that it was coming, it's like, it doesn't work, right? And I feel like the same thing is true with character design, right? Your job as a character designer is to show the audience who this character is. You design the character with a story in mind. And when people see that character, they should be able to tell what that character's role is, right? They should be able to see what they're supposed to see, basically, right? So, for example, if you have a character who is a villain, right? Like a classic, there's a great design. Maleficent from Sleeping Beauty is like just this super beautiful, perfect design that just is evil, right? She's just evil. That's her character, right? She's like evil personified. And you totally can tell that, right? Just looking at the design, you're like, okay, I know exactly who she is, exactly what she represents, and what her role is in the story. I mean, characters aren't always that simple, right? But even if you have a more complicated character with a more complicated story, that you have like sort of a dual nature or something, you can still allude to that. You can still give people hints as to, you know, what that character's role is and how they might turn or how they might change in the future. Speaking of, you mentioned Christopher Nolan earlier. My favorite film of his that I've seen is The Prestige.
Oh.
It's just like this, he has this awesome twist at the end, right? Which you can totally see coming, right? But because you can see it coming and you can connect the dots, like once there's this like final scene with the tanks, right? There's just like this huge payoff at that moment where you're like, oh my gosh, this is amazing, right? Because like when it happens, you're connecting all these dots that go all the way back, you know, to the beginning of the story. And if you haven't, so this is something that a lot of studios are fond of doing over the last several years, which I don't understand, is like this surprise villain that you don't see coming at the end, right?
Yeah.
Like, oh, guess what? He's the bad guy. He fooled you, right? Which is just stupid. And you can have, like, if you have a twist like that, right? If you have a character who makes this dramatic change, or there's this dramatic reveal about the character, there needs to be something connecting that change to what the audience has already seen, right? Because otherwise, it's just, if they don't get it, it's like a joke, right? You tell a joke, the punchline isn't what makes the joke funny, right? It's the setup. I feel like it's the same way with an audience. If you have a character, for example, Frozen, for a number of different reasons, but like the design of Hans drives me nuts. I hate it because there's absolutely no indication of his true nature, right? And people will like make all these excuses for, oh, he's wearing gloves, right? Gloves to hide something. Like everybody wears gloves, right? That's not enough. You have to, because you have to keep in mind, you know, they're creating this story for a young audience, right? This is it's a movie made for kids, and no kid is going to pick up on, oh, I think he might be a bad guy, right? Because there's absolutely, even for adults, right? But I mean, you kind of, now this trope has been done so much that people are like, you watch a movie and from the beginning, you're like, okay, who's the secret bad guy, right? Because yeah. It's just, that's how it's done now, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, the point is, if you do, you have to tell the character or tell the audience who the character is, right? If they're a character that's going to, you know, have this twist at the end, you have to have some clues in the story or in the design to let the audience know what's coming. Because, like, going back to the joke idea, when you get a joke, I think that it's funny, right? If you understand it, it's funny. But then there's a sort of self-congratulatory moment. You're like, oh, I get it. I'm so smart. Like, I'm so cool. I get the joke, right? And you and the whoever told the joke have this moment where you appreciate each other, right? You appreciate them for telling the joke and knowing that it was funny. And then you appreciate the fact that you got it, right? And you're like, it's more satisfying, right? So yeah. The same thing goes with storytelling. if an audience can put the clues together, right? If the setup is done right, if the design is done right, and the story is done right, when the twist comes or the punchline comes, it's like this, I get it. I'm so smart, right? And it's like this, it's a more satisfying experience that way. But anyway, it's a really long answer.
Yeah. Well, that's great because I had a follow-up question that I wanted to ask that you answered in that one too. It reminds me a little bit of murder mysteries, which is something my wife and I enjoy together. That like, it's sort of no fun if you get to the end and you discover you couldn't have figured that out because there were no clues. It's much more satisfying when you get to the end. The twist still surprises you and you realize you could have put that together if you had paid a little bit closer attention or not follow the red herring. So when you're working, you weren't mentioned working with clients. When you're working with clients, sometimes Netflix, DreamWorks or Disney or anyone else, how does that process tend to go?
Every job is different, right? And every studio has its own process and the way that they prefer to work. So with bigger studios, usually COVID has kind of changed things a little bit, the way that studios work kind of evolved a little bit during COVID, and now they're a lot more relaxed with hiring people outside of their organization for things. But usually the work I'd get from like DreamWorks, for example, was for pitches. Like, hey, we've got this show, like we bought the rights to this property or whatever, and we want to put a pitch together for the series. And so like, okay, here's this assignment, here's the show, we want you to put together, you know, designs for the pitch for us. And so there's this one job that was, they had like, there were like the two main characters, they had like a pretty good description of, and then there were 12 other characters. They're like, we don't really know what they're doing or who they are or anything, just kind of do whatever you want. It's like, that's awesome. So those ones are fun because it's like, they just kind of, they don't know what they're doing yet. And so it's kind of like, you get to be more a part of the process than you usually are. Right. So I was able to pitch story ideas, right? Like, what if this character did this thing, or what if they had this kind of a sidekick, or what if, you know, and that's always a lot of fun. But usually things are a lot more controlled than that, especially Disney. Although I did work on one job for Disney that they were just quick to approve everything. But usually with Disney, especially if it's, so I worked on Lorcana, which is this card game coming out this next year, and is dealing with all these classic Disney characters, right? You have all these, like you have Mickey Mouse, and you have like basically any Disney character you can think of. They have in this card game, right? And so they were very, very particular on everything, right? Especially the ones, some of them are like new takes on the character, right? But some of them are like canon, like this is the character from the film, and they're very, very particular on that sort of stuff. But yeah, like I said, it kind of varies from client to client, but usually the process is pretty similar. You have a go at rough concepts, and then, you know, slightly tighter concepts, and you just kind of go until you dial in on what exactly they want.
A couple of remaining questions as our time kind of winds down here. You've talked about turnarounds and model sheets, expression sheets. You know, what are kind of the tools or the skills that you would say probably every character designer who wants to be serious about the business should probably know how to do?
There's a host of skills that you probably should have, but I think the ones that are probably problematic for some people are things like, you need to be able to draw hands and feet, right? There are a lot of people that just avoid doing that, right? I don't want to draw hands, I don't want to draw feet, I'm just going to pretend that that's okay. like I've looked at a lot of portfolios and people draw these characters, they've just got like this beautiful face, you know, proportions are all looking good, but then they've got these like stumps for hands or something. I'm like, where are their hands? Like, oh, I'm not good at drawing hands. Well, you you need to be good at drawing hands. You kind of have to. That's part of the deal. I think just anatomy in general is usually important. Being able to wrap your mind around 3D form, right, and how to visualize a character in three dimensions, especially 2D animation. You need to be able to show the animators, you know, this is how the character moves, right? This is what they look like when they're jumping or when they're doing this or whatever. It's still important in 3D, right, to show all of that stuff. But now, especially in bigger, larger studios and stuff, a lot of the time you just do like a design. You don't have to do model sheets because they've got excellent modelers and riggers and animators that can just, they understand enough about the design, they can just go from there, right? But when you're working, especially in smaller studios and in 2D animation, that sort of thing, you need to be able to visualize the character in 3D and moving. And then the subtleties of expression, I think, can be tricky. I think just being an observer of people and being able to draw people and all their different attitudes and movements and that sort of stuff is, you know, vital.
But yeah, makes sense. Is that a monomyth maquette behind you there? Or?
Yes. I didn't actually sculpt this. This was done by Borislav Kacheski, who's amazing. And then he sent me the file and I had it 3D printed. But yeah, it turned out awesome. But this was the character that was like, I projected myself onto. Huh. And he was really hard for me. Which, I mean, you look at the character, I mean, the design isn't all that complex, right? But it took me forever because I was trying to just tell too much. And ultimately, I just decided it was most important for him to feel strong and clumsy, like graceful and clumsy. Like he's got all these contradictions. Anyway, it turned out okay, but it gave me a really hard time for a while. But
yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. Thanks for your time.